Good morning. It's June 4th. It's a Wednesday. My name is Chris, and this is Tech Talk Today. Good morning, everybody. So we're back with our third episode of the brand new Jupiter Broadcasting experiment, and I'm joined today by a Jupiter Broadcasting fan favorite. I'm sure you know him. You love him. You've seen him on our Linux Fest Northwest coverage. Hey there, Noah.
Good morning, Chris. Happy to be here with you today.
Well, good morning, sir. So last week, that's such an old habit. Yesterday on the show, I skipped doing the headlines, and our patrons on our Patreon page said, actually, I kind of like the headlines because I don't have a chance to download other podcasts all the time. So we're going to start with some of the news headlines that caught my attention today, and then we got a discussion topic around Amazon and Netflix we're going to get to. So first off, Valve is showing off an updated VR headset prototype with a Dota 2 demo. Now, this is what I like. So it looks a lot like the Oculus Rift, but it took a major upgrade recently. They're calling it the Crystal Cove Test Unit. It's a black wraparound device with an IR infrared dots. That's for tracking cameras. That allows those dots to keep the wearer where he's. That way, the camera can track where he's at. But what they've done here is this is a big change from their old system. They're combining these reflective trackers and accelerometers and gyroscopes in the device, and replacing what it used to be, which was cameras on the headset taking pictures of QR codes all around the room. That does seem like not exactly an elegant solution. So Valve even though Oculus is getting all the attention these days, Valve is still working on it. Now, something that's gotten people really excited is Google is releasing sort of their own version of name and shame in a sense. They're listing how and directly, you can go right to their website, you can put in one of your providers and get information just for you, or a general sense of the email providers out there that Google sends email to that support encryption. Obviously, Google has a lot of data running Gmail. And you can see right here, interestingly enough, one of the top domains to support SMTP encryption is AOL.com. And the domain that is most often not supporting encryption, guess what? Comcast.net. Oh, weird. Yes, I know. Amazon's also pretty good. Gmail has always supported email encryption using TLS. This is only in transit, you guys. This is not in storage. This does not mean that Gmail stored on Google servers is encrypted. I mean, it might be, but this is not what they're referring to. What they're referring to is TLS for the SMTP server. The important thing is that both sides in that exchange need to support TLS, and so what their data is showing is that approximately 40 to 50% of emails sent between Gmail and other email providers are not encrypted. Now, of course, that means they're susceptible to snooping. Now, Google has also announced a new Chrome extension. They're working on it right now. It's going to support end-to-end encryption in a Chrome extension for doing email encryption. I don't know if I'm all that excited about this. The details are out there right now on Google's official blog. The extension is in development, but I have a couple of key concerns. Number one, I don't really see what this does that you couldn't just accomplish in an external application, GPG the text and copy and paste into an email. It makes that process a little easier, though, I'll grant you that. But the second thing that really bothers me about this extension is it's inherent to the Chrome extension model in Chrome, is that it auto-updates. And when you have something that's as critical as encryption, I think that's something that the user is going to need to have absolute control over. Now, this is way out there, but it's already been brought up to the Google team, and they've already got a thread going discussing, well, what happens if one, there's some sort of man-in-the-middle attack for those extensions, and there's a bogus extension update that foils someone's encryption, or B, could Google be compelled to do an update based on a national security letter or some demand like that? They're already having discussions around that, but as is right now, the system is inherent to those kinds of extreme potential cases. So that's one thing to consider. So if you are all serious about getting your email encryption, you might want to check out Proto Mail. It's end-to-end encryption. It's based in Switzerland. And what's really cool about this is it's coming out of the guys at CERN. They've been working on it since summer of 2013. And the early Proto Mail hackathons were held at the actual CERN restaurant, which how about that? Huh? I hope they weren't drinking when they were doing it. So go to, you can find it at protomail.ch. And I haven't tried it yet myself, but it's gotten a lot of attention recently. They say it'll be available for everyone, forever free, fully anonymous, cross-platform, zero access, based in Switzerland, and they're really taking this seriously. It looks like a really good presentation. So, yeah, it's great that Google is naming and shaming folks who don't support TLS, and it's really cool that Google is working on a Chrome extension to support email encryption in Gmail. But if you're serious about this kind of stuff, look into doing GPG yourself. look into protomail and things like that. Okay, our next headline today, this one I just was like, what? Okay, time for a new gaming rig. Intel has reached 5 gigahertz with their new Core i7 chip. Now, don't get too excited. Because guess what? And I actually think this is maybe the more interesting part of this headline. Intel is quoting the overclocked speed now. Okay, is this a new thing? How long since Intel has been quoting overclock speeds? Intel is shipping a new Core i7 chip for gamers that runs at 4.4 gigahertz stock, but can be easily overclocked to 5 gigahertz with air cooling. The Core i7-4790K is a quad-core chip based on the Haswell microtexture. It draws only 88 watts of power, which is pretty good for something that could run at 4.4 gigahertz stock and is a quad-core. And it has an 8-megabyte cache, integrated graphics, so if you want the Iris graphics, you got it. Memory controllers and support for the latest I.O. technologies are also on the chip. It also supports multi-threading and allows cores to process two tasks at one time. Ooh, boy, you get that up at 5 gigahertz, and maybe The Witcher 2 will actually play pretty decently on Linux. And, ladies and gentlemen, there you go. Those are the headlines. And the one story I wanted to kind of talk with you about, Noah, are you a Netflix user?
I used to be, and I actually I discontinued my membership when I kind of gave a stronger commitment to Linux, and I sent them an email, and I'm sure it did nothing, but I told them, I said, I'm discontinuing my membership because until you guys support Linux, and I went to Amazon Prime.
Good for you. Wow. Wow. Look at you. Now, it's not much better on Prime because they're using Flash, of course, but backing up a little bit, now Safari on the new OS X Yosemite is using HTML5. So maybe there is hope in the near future for the Linux desktop. Here's something, though, that is kind of making me proud of Netflix a little bit, because they're struggling with all of these different ISPs who do not want to give them a ton of transit bandwidth. So Netflix, after striking a deal with Verizon, I am suspecting hasn't seen a lot of returns from that deal. So Vox media designer Yuri Victor was trying to watch Netflix on his MacBook, and he ended up seeing a message on his browser blaming Verizon for the slow speeds. And if you're watching the video version, you can see it right here. It says in the Netflix error message, it says, "The Verizon network is crowded right now. Adjusting for few other playback. Please stand by." And it's buffering. And right there, they're naming and shaming Verizon for the problem. Now, usually they would be a little more smooth about this. They wouldn't necessarily just, you know, name an ISP like that. So Recode reached out to Netflix, and they said, "Oh yeah, this is just a test. We're a test, just seeing to let people know when networks are congested. It isn't specific to Verizon. We'll see whether they think it's valuable or not." So Recode reached out to Verizon, and Verizon responded if they thought it was valuable or not. "This is a PR stunt. We are investigating this claim, but it seems misleading and could confuse people." Now, of course, Netflix has been publishing scorecards that rank ISPs by speed, and Google just recently started doing the same for YouTube. But I think it's surprising that Netflix is doing this for Verizon customers, since you would assume they have struck that deal, they'd have better price and better speeds. I'm guessing that Netflix hasn't gotten Verizon to get off their butt. Noah, this seems to be a growing problem, and I kind of worry about in the distant future when everybody is going to have problems like this. Sites like Jupiter Broadcasting. What happens when Jupiter Broadcasting goes 4K, Noah?
Well, so I have a couple of thoughts. First off, you said you're proud of Netflix for shaming Verizon, but that's one side. On the other side, don't you think that this could also be a ploy to support the idea of getting rid of net neutrality? I mean, if they get all of their Netflix customers to complain and say, "Listen, we want faster speeds, but every time I try and do it on Verizon, it says it's a little too slow," and then Verizon can then say, "Well, here's our evidence of why we have to be able to give them a special pipe to get traffic through because our customers are complaining."
Well, I will tell you this. I think the whole internet has bought into this net neutrality war, and we're all on board on going common carrier status for ISPs, and I think everybody's whole hog on an idea that could end up being absolutely disastrous. And I would think it would be one of the, and I'm not even going to exaggerate a little bit here, it would be one of the largest tragedies of our lifetimes if we sacrifice the innovation potential of the internet so that way we could all watch House of Cards a little better.
Right, and I can, and so I guess going back to your original question, I agree that I think that if ISPs don't maintain a high level of down, you know, down bandwidth, you're going to have problems going to something like 4K moving forward. But, you know, and you had mentioned, I think, in the past, and I thought this idea really struck a chord with me. If you had a 4K camera, just because you have a 4K camera, it doesn't mean you have to send a 4K downstream to actually get the benefits of a 4K camera. What you can do is with your virtual cameras, take a crop shot, and then that crop shot actually becomes higher resolution.
Right, yeah. Yeah, that's how we would probably use it here for quite a while. But I look at this and I think, so I have, I guess, I mean, you must have worked with telcos in the client services industry. You know how these guys operate. I could clearly see Netflix strikes a bandwidth deal with Verizon. They sign it on the dotted line. Everybody shakes hands. Everybody's, whew, we solved that problem. And then nothing changes because nothing ever changes at Verizon. Because have you ever had to work with Verizon?
Yeah. We use Verizon is basically the only, I shouldn't say the only, but the biggest mobile provider that we work with in the enterprise world. If there's a company going to roll out 10,000 phones, it's probably on Verizon.
Well, the mobile is even a whole different beast than the Verizon LAN, you know, like the big pipes and the phone. I mean, it's like working with a company from the 1800s. I think they still communicate interdepartment via telegram. And they have these weird firewalls that are set up from legal requirements where one department can't talk to another department directly. And they have to go through these third-party companies, and they always screw it up. I mean, I got to tell you, in some way, I think I see what your point is. And this is pushing forward on a debate that people don't really have, like even in the chat room right now, Rotten Corpses, they need to classify ISPs as utilities. The ramifications of doing that, I don't think we fully appreciate or understand. And so I don't know if I want us to be, I don't want to speed down that decision lane. However, at the same time, I also can see this from Netflix's standpoint, having worked with Verizon in the past, and know that they're just a bunch of stuck-in-the-mud, do-nothing, drop-the-ball group of people. I mean, I don't mean to be so critical, but it is really, working with Verizon was one of the most frustrating things I did, because I worked at a bank where we had, anywhere between, at one point, 37 up to some over 50 remote branches all going through Verizon point-to-point T1s or whatever that we could get in that area. So it was this massive part of my job, and it became the most infuriating aspect of my job because they are so unresponsive, they're so large, and they essentially are a monopoly in that area, so they don't even have to care. And that's the problem, Noah. That's Netflix is transitioning from an up-and-start internet company that's doing this crazy thing with DVDs and streaming videos to, like, a serious contender for content distribution. And sure. And they're just outclassing what I think these big networks are willing to invest.
Well, my thought on it is I agree with Rotten Corpse that at some point we do need to reclassify. But don't you think the appropriate time to bring that up was a couple of years ago when the ISPs came to the federal government and said, hey, guys, we want to spend all this money on investing in infrastructure. Is this going to be a public thing, or do we get to maintain private domain over this stuff? And then the FCC said, no, you guys can keep it. It's yours. You spend the money, it's yours.
Yeah. Yeah, the time kind of was then, wasn't it? I don't know. I'm actually not so convinced that having them as utilities is a good idea. I don't think monopolies is a good idea either, though, so I don't... It's kind of a bad situation. I'll tell you a good situation, though. No, I am really excited. The Tech Talk Today Patreon is doing excellent. We have 91 patrons, which brings our total to $641.33 a month, which means we have reached our first two milestones in just the first week of broadcasting. I am really very, very humbled by that, you guys. Thank you very much. And so at this point, now with these milestones, the show's staying, and the video version is staying around. The next milestone is sponsor free, and this is one I would really love to get soon because I'm in this weird phase where I've got people asking to sponsor, but I'm not saying yes yet because I'm not sure where the Patreon's going to go. So, if you're liking where Tech Talk Today is going and you want to keep it sponsor free, please jump in at patreon.com/today. The revenue generated from this Patreon page goes into it's invested in Jupiter Broadcasting. That's where all this money raised goes, and we have different pledge levels, including pledges that include swag. And let's see, there's 45 of those left. I don't know how much I want to say. We've already designed our first swag product, and it's awesome. So if you want to jump in there, You probably, if you get in there this weekend, you might get it. You might, because we're going to send it out soon as a thank you for people jumping on the Tech Talk Today Patreon. So there's three patrons right now at the Swag Club level. That's the highest pledge level. And if you get in over the weekend, and I'd say we probably have about eight more slots available. We have enough swag for this first round. The first Tech Talk Today swag is so close. And man, you know what would be awesome, Noah? You know what would blow my mind? Is if we got
what
to
would blow your mind?
If we got to 100 patrons by Monday's episode. We're at 91 right now at patreon.com/today. If we got to 100 by Monday's episode, I'd be on just like the cloud for the whole week. It'd be like I'd be a happy camper. So patreon.com/today. Thanks you guys for not only supporting the show but the network too. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, let me get this straight. You only need 9 more people to sign up to make you happy the entire weekend.
Well, I think so, yeah. I think that's all it would take. Make for a great weekend, and we still have one more show this week, too. So you never know what could happen. Tomorrow's the last show of the week. And then the first week of Tech Talk Today will be in the bag, Noah, in the bag. I'm kind of excited. If you know what I'm doing, is it's just like, all right, well, I'm going to try to get into the studio every day at the same time. That way, everybody who works and all our various, you know, all the producers and everybody that works, it's getting to be a big crew now, knows where Chris is at every single time that, you know, they need to book something. He's in the studio starting at 9 a.m. doing a show, and then he's off the air a little bit after that. And so really what the show is going to become is, you know, you guys hang out with me as I show up to work. I'm always going through the headlines for all the various shows, and so the ones that jumped out at me for today, we'll talk about them with friends, and I have some ideas too, like, I really have this probably irrational goal to just get out on the road and travel and just go see people and do mini meetups all over the place. And I think it would be so awesome to chronicle that travel on a daily show as much as possible. I don't know how feasible that would be depending on connectivity and whatnot. But I mean, you know, if it can support a Skype or a Mumble connection, I could probably do it from just about anywhere. And then we would go there and we would do our big shows. But the journey of getting there and then leaving there and meeting up with people, that, you know, all of that would be captured in the daily show. So I'm hoping this becomes sort of, you know, it's going to be a living show that's always changing. And when it's daily like that, I think that's a good thing. But we'll try to keep it focused on technology and things like that. So I'd love your support. Patreon.com/today.
Well, Chris.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, what I was going to say is one thing that I think is really important to this show and what really excites me is the idea that there's the idea of the gatekeeper in communication, right? Anytime you trust media, you have to trust that they have an agenda. Everyone has an agenda, and everyone's biased, even if they try and hide it or even if they don't try and show it. And so with a show like Tech Talk Today, we get the opportunity to hear you present news that might not otherwise fit your other shows. They're not big enough stories, or they're not full enough stories to fit the other shows. But the gatekeeper is someone we can trust, someone who has Linux's best interest at heart.
Yeah, thank you. That's my goal, is to not to have the Linux angle be an overpowering influence on the show, but to give the news events of the day their due from the perspective of the Linux community and open source advocates. Because honestly, I have a lot of respect for the daily tech shows that are out there, especially Tom Merritt's show. And Tom's a great guy. He's got a Linux laptop. But at the end of the day, you know, he's in the Mac, Windows, Google, Facebook, Apple world very, very strongly. And he doesn't really keep up to date on what's going on over here and doesn't really see it from the perspective of open and community and what open source is already accomplished or where it's going and the conflicts that are going on in there. And I feel like bringing some of that to the general news coverage helps sort of cover it from at least that group's perspective to some extent, sort of gives that group a perspective on the daily events. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. But I hope you're right, Noah. All right, well, I'm going to drag us up to talk to the rest of the Mumble Room here, because I wanted to talk to you guys. Now, I hope I don't come across as having an axe to grind with Amazon here, because they canceled. I mean, full disclosure, back in November of 2013, Amazon ended their affiliate relationship with Jupiter Broadcasting. Now, I really, you know what? That those kinds of things happen. I hope this doesn't come across as me grinding an axe. But instead, I hope what we're going to do here is just raise a couple of interesting discussion points around a company that I'm willing to bet a lot of us use heavily. I mean, I'm a Prime member. I have been for years and years and years. I've got a living room full of boxes right now from Amazon. But that said, things are not all good in the land of Amazon. I don't know how familiar you guys are with this hatchet dispute that Amazon's been in. They've been in on since the beginning of the year, but it's really just becoming public now. And Amazon's playing some serious hardball here where they're trying to negotiate lower prices to pay the publisher. And in doing so, to play hardball, they're taking their items off the bookshelves, theoretically bookshelves at Amazon. You know, they're marking them out of stock. They're not allowing pre-orders on new popular releases. And these guys are the fourth largest publisher out there. And at this point, Amazon now sells about 50% of all book sales. That's physical and electronic in the U.S. In the past decade, the company has steadily grown in market share, taking it from Barnes & Noble and Borders, and they're banking independent bookstores all around the world, or all around the U.S. Around 2,000 bookstores remain today, independent bookstores. There were 7,000 bookstores in the late 90s. Now, there's a lot of factors for that, but Amazon has become the clear go-to place for things like books, right? I mean, I think we could all admit that. The Kindle is a huge hit. But the problem is, they're now using this monopoly position to really screw these guys. And we have seen them do this in app stores as well. We have seen them do this with app makers where they would discount their app when they, maybe somebody put it in there for $3.99 and Amazon would give it away for free. Now, they've pulled back from that a little bit. We've seen them make maneuvers like this before. And Amazon's defense is, well, the customer expects it to be cheap. That's our promise. That's our pledge to the customer. And on top of that, Bezos himself seems I have some problems with. He was just recently, by the way, voted the world's worst boss. Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos is the world's worst boss, according to an international trade union confederation, the ITUC. More than 20,000 workers voted for 9 bosses who exemplified the worst behavior and abuses in workers' rights, tax avoidance, and corporate bullying and other abuses. Bezos resoundingly won. Jeff Bezos represents the inhumanity of employees who are promoting the American corporate model. This is a message. This is in their message. And they say, this is a message we are sending to big business to back off. You are not going to mistreat workers, said a spokesperson. So guys, mumble room. Let's start with Noah. Noah, do you have concerns about Amazon? Do you think this is blown out of proportion? Or have you heard some rumblings yourself?
Okay, so I know a lot of people. We have an Amazon, I don't know if it's a shipping depot or what, but we have Amazon that's here in Grand Forks, and they run Linux. And I've known a lot of people that have worked for Amazon. And granted, I'm sure Jeff Bezos is far removed from what's actually happening in little old Grand Forks, North Dakota. But the people that work at Amazon here are extremely happy and speak very highly of Amazon. In fact, I had a good friend of mine graduated college with a degree in air traffic control, and he went down and he got a job making $60,000 a year working for Fargo Tower, and he even has regrets about leaving Amazon because he had so much fun there.
Interesting. Yeah, and I've also worked with a couple of guys who worked in the IT divisions of Amazon, and they had, you know, their stories about how crazy things were from time to time. But overall, I think they seemed to think it was a positive experience as well.
There's a member of JB community who works at Amazon, and he talks about he likes it a lot.
So I wonder where this is coming from. And I do believe that Amazon plays hardball with these book publishers. I think this is something Amazon is probably doing. I think they are hurting this company financially. So it's a mixed bag. It's like with all these companies, it's not black and white. When Amazon shut down our affiliate system, it felt more than just like a cold corporate maneuver. It felt hostile because not only did they shut down our affiliate system, but then they shut down some people that were not directly affiliated with us, but they shut down other people associated with Jupiter Broadcasting's affiliate accounts too, without any really good reason. And the policy they used to shut our system down was a bit of a loophole that they could just play when they wanted to. And so I saw that. I was like, oh, that's kind of – but, you know, that's just kind of thing that happens from time to time. It's like it really sucks. And, it hurt us really bad financially. In fact, we're still limping from it. But it was like one of those things where it's like, okay, that's – you're going to have to expect that's going to happen. You can't count on any one thing to last. But when I hear these stories about the way they've sort of – strong-arm developers or the way they're strong-arming the book publishers, I worry about maybe this is a tendency that's beginning to develop as they grow larger and larger. And I'll tell you why, you guys. I've been reading a book called The Everything Store, Jeff Bezos and the Age of Amazon. I put a link to the audiobook in the show notes. I really recommend it. If you shop at Amazon a lot or if you think about these kinds of things a lot, it's a very good read. And they really are trying, and this is, boy, it sounds like I'm really grinding an axe here, but their goal really is to replace everybody who sells everything.
But wasn't there a response from Bezos' wife about that book?
Of course. Yeah, yeah.
The part about the book thing, book publisher thing, is I think it's a negative thing and a good thing. If you think about it, it's negative to the book publishers, but the book publishers are negative to the customers when they charge an exorbitant amount
of
money
for
a book. That's like, let's say you could buy books on in Amazon for $10. That same exact book with like the hardcover book would be like $10. You go to like any kind of Books a Million store or something like that, and that same book in paperback would be like $30. It's ridiculous.
I agree.
I think this whole Amazon's quote unquote nuclear options to negotiation with Hatchett reminds me a bit of the Apple's ebook fixing issue that we had a number of years back. And there was quite a bit of uproar because essentially that was Apple saying, listen, you either have to play ball with us and give our customers a lower price, or you can't sell for to millions and millions of customers your merchandise, your publishing.
You kind of have it backwards. So what Apple was trying to fight for was for the publisher to be able to set their own price, and then Apple was just going to take a straight percentage. So if they wanted to put a book in at $15 instead of $9.99, Apple was going to allow them to do it. So actually, it was worse for the customer. Apple was going to allow them to charge the customer more. The thing is that the arrangement that Amazon and the book publishers have fixes those price at a specific price. But then the other thing that Amazon has done in some cases is they have signed a contract saying you cannot set your book higher priced anywhere else. And when they're already selling it below the price they want at Amazon. So what happened in that case is Amazon went after Apple because Steve Jobs did legitimately collude with the book publishers, because what they were trying to do was break Amazon's hold on this market. They failed to do that, and I believe what we are seeing today are actually since the beginning of 2014, where they've been this fight with Hatch has been going on since January. This just really become public in the last few weeks. I suspect that if that Apple case had not failed for Apple, Amazon would not be in a position to do this right now.
Well, I was doing devil's advocate for Amazon, but then I didn't know about the fact that they had that limit where you couldn't charge different prices other places or more. That's messed up.
Well, and they got Apple on a pretty good technicality, because they got emails from Jobs where he was like, "Yeah, we're gonna get Amazon." So they screwed the pooch on that one. When I read the Everything book, what I realized was we are quickly and emphatically building the next big monopoly. In a really real, but not a monopoly like anything else, a monopoly on cloud services, a monopoly on book sales, a monopoly on diaper delivery, a monopoly on everything. They are going to, you know what's going to stop Walmart? Amazon. They're going to crush Walmart. They also extracted a whole bunch of good talent out of Walmart early on. And
online-wise, they've already destroyed Walmart.
Yes, big time. So I guess what I'm trying to get to, you guys, is even though we're all like, privacy this and consumer rights that, we constantly keep building up these huge frickin' monopolies. We constantly keep building up these giant monopolies. Why do we do it? Are we just sheep?
Well, I mean, it gets to the point where, like, you buy from a company because you like them.
Yeah.
And by the time you realize that they've gotten to the point where they need to be taken down a notch, you have two options. Take your business somewhere else, which at that point, there's probably not very many, if any, people that can compete, or regulate them, which half the people in the country don't want to do out of idealism. But even if you did want to do it, that company now has the money and resources to pay for the campaigns and lobbyists that would prevent it.
Right. And the other thing that Amazon has going for it is Amazon was actually started by an investment firm. And this is one of the reasons why Amazon's never really had to make a profit, is because they're being financed by a group of bankers. And they have essentially huge checkbooks that Jeff can go to. Now, he's under a lot of pressure now to turn that around, because it's been like 10 years that they've just been writing him checks. But that is kind of a tactical advantage that, nobody else could compete with, because essentially it's like, yeah, go build out the world's largest distribution centers, build warehouses all over the world, hire staffs, build out a huge cloud infrastructure, and by the way, you don't have to make any money doing it. How can you compete with that? And it's, in some ways, I'm one of the biggest Amazon sluts around. I spend tons of money with them every year. And I'm just willfully doing it. So I'm not trying to shame anybody, but I'm just trying to raise awareness about something that, I'm going to keep using them. I'm going to use Amazon Prime. I'm going to use instant streaming. I'm going to subscribe and save. Yes, I'm going to do these things, but I'm going to do it aware of what's going on and trying to keep myself informed. So that way, if I feel like I do need to taper back and maybe buy a little more local, a little more often, you know, I can keep aware of that kind of thing. And I just wanted to pass along. I've got more notes and links, including... Go ahead.
Couldn't you, if Amazon does have such a monopoly and such complete control over the system, aren't there legal options that somebody could pursue, like no trust lawsuits or anti-monopoly lawsuits or so on and so forth? Isn't there some legal action that could be taken?
Maybe.
You can take it, but the problem becomes that ultimately those actions that you take are in the hands of people who make decisions, and those decisions are based on input and opinion coming from either your group or the hundreds of Amazon lobbyists. So right now I wouldn't say that Amazon has a complete monopoly on everything, but if they're continually making profits and they're continually edging further and further into the percentage of market share of all these different markets, then it will ultimately lead to such a case. And even now they have such influence in certain arenas like book sales that even if they're not a monopoly, it can cripple a company if they just decide not to sell your
product. In fact, the regulators have sort of signaled, we're going to kind of let Amazon do what they're doing. Let it work it out. Roddenkorps, why don't you wrap us up on the conversation? You think it might be kind of too late to switch anyways?
Maybe not too late, but it's almost. I mean, it's so hard to switch away from Amazon. As someone who's Amazon pissed off in the past, like, for example, I'm a huge XBMC user, and there was a XBMC for Amazon Prime, which it forced you to be a Prime user on. So you couldn't use add-on without being a Prime user and paying them for Prime. But they decided to just cripple it anyway and abandon it. So though you were...
Yeah. Your bandwidth's breaking up, Rodney.
They screwed me over a little bit,
I'm still a Prime user. Yeah. No, I know. I'm in the same spot. I mean, they really hurt us, but I still use them, and I just kind of keep it separated. I have a lot of links in the show notes. We're going long. One of the other bits of feedback I got is people asked me to shorten this up a little bit. I'll try to do that tomorrow, okay? I'll try to make a shorter show tomorrow. We'll see how that goes. It's an experiment. One thing, though, I wanted to point you to the show notes. Amazon's going to have 10,000 robots filling your orders by the end of this year, if everything goes as planned, and Business Insider has some videos of how these robots will work. Now, don't get all excited. They're not super. They're basically like Tim Allen Roombas. Like if Tim Allen got a Roomba, whoa, I'm going to empower it and, you know, gave it some more power, put a gas motor on it. Actually, it's electric. That's what they are. They're like Roombas that can move stuff, but it's pretty cool, and they got videos of it. There's also a link to that book, Amazon, The Everything Store. It's an audiobook. That's the one I got. I really recommend it. It really opened my eyes about a lot of things that I've wondered, like, how can they not make money? How does that actually work? And all those other things. And now, we're going to end with a classic commercial of something you could buy on Amazon. Good night, kids, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Hey, kids, let me tell you about something that happened here at the ranch the other afternoon. It was just about dinner time, and Dale and I were just getting back from town. In fact, we were late, and Dale was worrying about making supper, so she jumped right out and hurried inside. And when she got inside the kitchen, she found all the kids making dessert with Jell-O instant pudding. Dale was just as proud as she could be, and they sure whipped that pudding up quick and easy, too. You know, with Jell-O instant pudding, you just empty the package into a bowl that has some cold milk in it, and then you beat it up. There's no trick to it at all. And kids, you just never ate a better tasting dessert anywhere, whether it's butterscotch, vanilla, or chocolate. So ask your mom to get some Jell-O instant puddings for you real soon. And then the next time she's busy, you can have the swellest dessert in the whole world all ready for her. Don't forget the name. It's Jell-O instant puddings. And now, how about singing the Jell-O instant pudding song with us? You ready?
Sure are.
Okay, here we go.
Never too late to make dessert with Jell-O instant pudding.
So get the busy day dessert.
Jell-O instant pudding.
It's so easy a kid can make dessert
with Jell-O instant pudding.
So get the busy day dessert.
Jell-O instant pudding.
Yep, you get some Jell-O instant puddings in all three flavors. Vanilla,
chocolate, and butter.